Hello students, here Himali Shah. Today we are going to study about the shortest job first scheduling algorithm. So what do you mean by the scheduling algorithm? That is an algorithm which the process having a smallest execution time is chosen for the next execution. That means what? We have already studied in FCFS, that is the first come first serve, which process come first, that is considered for the execution first. So, in shortest job first, we have to consider the smallest execution time to chosen for the next execution. This scheduling method can be preemptive or non-preemptive. As we discuss, for the preemptive scheduling algorithm, that means the high priority process come first, and non-preemptive scheduling algorithm, in this scheduling algorithm we have to consider that process voluntary comes out or terminated, then and then next process come for the execution. So the non-preemptive scheduling algorithm for this algorithm, that is called as the shortest job first, and preemptive, that is the SRTN, shortest remaining time next. So today we are going to discuss about the non-preemptive scheduling algorithm, that is the SJF. We can also say that is shortest job next. So characteristics of SJF scheduling algorithm, that is associated with the each job as a unit of time to complete. This algorithm method is helpful for the batch type processing where waiting for the job to the complete, it's not critical. It can be improved the process throughput by the making sure that the shortest jobs are executed first. Hence, possibly have the shortest turnaround time. It improves the job output by the offering the shortest jobs which should be executed first, which mostly have the shortest turnaround time. So this is about the characteristics of SJF scheduling algorithm. Now, with non-preemptive scheduling, that is once the CPU cycle is allocated to the process holds it till it reaches waiting state or terminated. So this is about the non-preemptive SJF. Let's see about the example of SJF. So in exam we have to given the process, bus time and the arrival time. So here five processes consider, first P1, P2, P3, P4 and P5. So arrival time of P1, that is 2, arrival time of P2, that is 5, P3 1, P4 0 and P5 4. So in this scheduling algorithm we have to consider the arrival time first. So minimum arrival time, that is the P4. That means we can say the P4 process has come first. So we have to continue with the P4 process, that is the arrival time 0 and the bus time, that is a 3. So its execution to be continued up to the 3 number of unit, right? So next, so 0 to 3, that means P3 process and P1 process is considered up to the 3. Why? Because the arrival time is up to 3, that is given by the P3 and P1, 1 and 2. So now what we have to do, first at arrival time 0, P4 process comes. So execution of P4 process is continue up to the number of unit 3, right? Finished. Now the up to 3 bus time, which process comes? P3 and P1. So P3 and P1, but bus time, we have to consider the bus time. Which process has the smallest job that is considered to be executed next? Okay, so P3 process bus time, that is 8, and P1 process the bus time, that is the 6. So which is smallest? That is the P1. So P1 is considered to be execute next. Now P1 is finished and P4 is also finished. So now P1 up to the 6. So 3 plus 6, that will be 9. 9 up to the 9, which process comes? P3, P5 and P2. Again we have to consider the burst time of particular process. So P3 burst time, that is 8, P5 burst time, that is a 4, and P2, that is burst time 2. So which process come next? That is a P2. So next P2 process comes. That is up to the 2 unit of time. So 9 plus 2, that will be 11. So now next 0 to 11. So remaining process are P3 and P5. P3 and P5, then which process have the smallest burst time? That is again we have to check. So P4, burst time of the P5, that is a 4, and burst time of the P3, that is a 8. So which is the minimum? That is a P5. So next process comes P5, that is up to 4. 11 plus 4, that will be 15. Now the remaining process, that will be P3. So now the P3 burst time of the P3, that will be 8. So 15 plus 8, that will be 23. Meanwhile, again consider the 3, 9, 11, 15 and 23. These are the finish time of the particular process. So we can say the finish time of P4 process, that will be 3, finish time of P1, that will be 9, finish time of P2, that will be 11, finish time of the P5 process, that will be 15, and finish time of the P3 process, that will be 23. So now next we have to make a table. Process, arrival time, burst time and the finish time, turnaround time and the waiting time. So finish time, we have already seen the P1. See P1 process, that will be 9. So we have written over here 9. P2 process 11. So here the 11. P3 process, that will be 23. P4 process, that will be 3. So here 3. And the P5 process, that will be 15, right? So here written 15. As we know, the turnaround time, that is the finish time minus arrival time. So 9 minus 2, that will be 7. 11 minus 5, that will be 6. 23 minus 1, that will be 22. 3 minus 0, that will be 3. And 15 minus 4, that will be 11. So this is all about the turnaround time. If we are talking about the waiting time, then waiting time formula, that is the turnaround time minus burst time. So 7 minus 6, that will be 1. 6 minus 2, that will be 4. 22 minus 8, that will be 14. 3 minus 3, that will be 0, and 11 minus 4, that will be 7. So now if we are going to find about the average waiting time and average turnaround time, then this is about the average turnaround time. So nothing else, we have to sum of these particular values, 7 plus 6 plus 22 plus 3 plus 11. That will be 63 divided by 5, 9.8 milliseconds. An average waiting time, we have to sum of this value, 1 plus 4 plus 14 plus 0 plus 7. So this is the 1 plus 4 plus 14 plus 0 plus 7, that is 26 divided by 5. Why divide by 5? because we have the 5 process. So 26 divided by 5, that will be 5.2 milliseconds. So this is all about the shortest job first, or we can say shortest job next. Now, the advantage and disadvantage of SJF. So advantage of SJF, that is frequently used for the long-term scheduling. It reduces the average waiting time. This is the most important advantage over FCFS. We have already seen in FCFS, the average waiting time is more. That's why the performance decreases, right? So this is the overcome of FCFS, that is reducing the average waiting time. Now next, the SJF method gives the lowest average waiting time for the specific set of the processes. And it is appropriate for the jobs running in the batch where the run time are known as advanced. For the batch operating system, or we can say long-term scheduling, a burst time estimate can be obtained from the job description. So probably optimal with the regard of the average turnaround time. So these are the advantage of SJF. Now the disadvantage of SJF, that is the job completion time must be known earlier. Then and then you can use of the SJF. But that is hard to predict, right? So that is the disadvantage of SJF. It is often used to batch operating system, as we discussed. It is very useful for the long term scheduling. So it is often used in the batch operating system for the long term scheduling. Okay. So SJF can't be implemented for the CPU scheduling for the short term. It is because that is no specific method to the predict the length of the upcoming CPU burst. Right? So that is algorithm may cause a very long turnaround time or starvation. That is a big disadvantage of the SJF starvation. Require the knowledge of how to long a process or job will be run, and that is lead to starvation that doesn't reduce the average turnaround time. It is hard to know the length of the upcoming CPU request. And this is all about the disadvantage of SJF.
Thank you.